Okay, Peggy.
This morning. Okay. All right. Looking at our bulletin first, I want to thank everyone who donated and helped with Lifeline yesterday. We were able to help about 40 families, so it went really well. Looking at the next week, I would like to point out the Thursday morning prayer group. If you've never been a part of that, it is absolutely wonderful. We meet at 8 a.m. And have a short devotional and just some prayer time. And then also on Thursday morning, our card ministry that is still new and getting off the ground. And please, if you have any addresses of people on the prayer list who are not in the church directory, get those to Connie. I would also like to ask, looking to September 7th, that is our first day of preschool. If you are available that morning, we need just a few volunteers to come and help with the Boohoo breakfast. The children will not be crying. They'll be fine. The parents were worried about. So if you could stand in the fellowship hall and comfort, maybe hand a tissue while they eat donuts, we could use you that morning from 8:30 to about 10. All right. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalms 138. I thank you, Lord, and with all the passion of my heart, I worship you in the presence of angels. Heaven's mighty ones will hear my voice as I sing my loving praise to you. I bow down before your divine presence and bring you my deepest worship as I experience your tender love and your living truth. For your word and the fame of your name have been magnified above all else. For though you are lofty and exalted, you stoop to embrace the lowly. You keep every promise you've ever made to me. Since your love for me is constant and endless, I ask you, Lord, to finish every good thing that you've begun in me. Join me in prayer. God, we come to you this morning and thank you for allowing us to gather safely in your presence, to worship you together, and to do so freely. We bring to you all of the concerns on our prayer list, as many have been added in the last week. And as always, we pray for healing in our community and in our world. I'd like to bring a special prayer to you this morning for the teachers and students and bus drivers and staff who start back to school tomorrow. God, keep them safe and watch over them and help them get back to having some sense of routine and normalcy. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Good morning.
Creation.
You know, there is so much for us to be in prayer for. There's so much on the news and so much going on around the world that just concerns us, and there's so much for us to be on our knees and to just be praying to God for. But as that song just sang, there is so much for us to be praising God for. I got to tell you, yesterday I had a wonderful privilege. I got to go to a birthday party to an old friend. He just turned 90 years old. And so I got to go and say hi to him and to wish him a happy birthday, and it was great to see him. But as we were there, an old friend came in, and we got to hug on her a little bit and love on her. Now, this was a woman who, in 2019, she had the flu, and she was in the hospital for literally 6 months. She was on death's doorstep, and she was just, I mean, she actually said, "Pastor, will you pray for me?" I said, "Yes, I will." She said, "Pray that I will die." And I was like, "Well, that's not up to me," you know. But we prayed and prayed, and her family went through a whole lot. But yesterday, I got to sit there, and she walked in, and I saw her, and I got to hug on her, and it was such a beautiful thing. And it reminded me that we pray, and God hears. Sometimes that prayer is answered one way, and other times answered another. But I always go back to this hope that I think is so beautiful. The Apostle Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." As Christians, we have a hope that the world cannot touch, that the world cannot offer anything close to. And so no matter what we're praying about this morning, no matter what we're going through, we have a God who deserves our praise. We have a God who is worthy of our adoration, because our God is unlike any other. He is above all and worthy of our worship. So as we go into prayer this morning, the altar rail is open for you to come and to pray. And I encourage you to come and make use of it. Pray for the needs that are in your heart, but also if you just want to come and say thank you, the altar rail is open. Let's bow our heads and prepare our hearts to go, Lord, in prayer. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, I lift my eyes unto the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from you, the maker of heaven and earth. Father, you are glorious. And Lord, as we have seen so much go on in our world, Lord, our heart breaks, it aches for what others are going through. For all the trials and tribulations people are enduring, for all the sickness and despair, it seems like it's at the point of overwhelming us. But Lord, when we feel like we are at our wits' end, when we feel like we have no more strength, Lord, you are always there. When we grow tired of holding on to the rope, you are the one who grabs and holds on for us. Lord, you are our strength. You are our hope. And Father, I pray that you would fill this place with that hope. Lord, may our eyes be focused on you. May we look at your glory. May we look at your love and your mercy. May we see just how much you love us and how much you care for us. And Father, may you remind us of the hope we have as believers in this risen Savior, that death is not the end. But Lord, there is so much prepared for us. Lord, you are such a glorious God, and we are so grateful. Father, I pray for all the names in our prayer list. Father, I thank you for the way that you're at work in their lives and for the way that you are encouraging them. Lord, I thank you for the card ministry that started up on Thursday and the little words of encouragement that are being sent out. I pray, Lord, that every time someone receives one of those cards, they will be reminded that there are people praying for them and people who care. And Father, I pray for us as we are gathered here this day. Lord, fill our hearts with wonder. Remind us of who we are in Christ. And Lord, may we lift high the cross of Christ. May we lift high his resurrection. May we lift high his presence with us. Lord, we are not alone. We are not forsaken. I pray, Lord, that you would draw us closer to you. For anyone who feels alone, may your Holy Spirit touch them and remind them that they are not. And Lord, whatever it is we need to hear this morning, may we hear it loud and clear from you. Lord, thank you for all you have blessed us with. Thank you for all that you have given to us. And I pray that our words and our songs will glorify your holy name. It is with this confidence that we now pray the prayer that our Savior taught us to pray as we say as one, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
I want to share a little story with you.
Whoa.
Yesterday during Lifeline, and I don't know if Vicky and Holley and Lyndy saw this. I think Vicky and, I mean, Holley and Lyndy were out there with us at the time. A lady drove up, and I think she had maybe her sister or somebody in the car. I forgot who it was now. But anyway, as we were passing the food tour, we were meeting that need of the food ministry. But there was also a need. This lady just spit out to me, and she said, I want you to be sure and pray for us. And then she went on to tell us about somebody in her family had died and wasn't COVID-related. But the point I'm trying to get across to you is that it was more than just handing out food. It was for them reaching out to help for us and say, I want you to pray for us. And we're glad to pray with them and pray for them. But I thought that was so neat that she just said, I want you to pray for this. So if you ever need that blessing for Lifeline Ministry, please feel free to come. And it kind of leads into this next song. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still and with all who will trust and obey. Hymn number 467, if you'd like to use your hymnal, we'll sing the first and last stanzas. Trust and obey. Let's stand as we sing.
He abides with us still.
This time the ushers come forward, let us prepare our hearts as we give back to God our tithes and offerings. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, you have blessed our lives in so many glorious ways. Father, as we return these tithes and offerings unto you, I pray they will be used to further your kingdom so that the whole world may know the joy and the blessing of knowing Jesus Christ. Lord, may we share his love with others. May you bless these tithes and offerings. Bless both the gift and the giver. For in Christ we pray. Amen. This time, if we can have all of our kids come forward for a moment with children. Here's Lincoln. All right, everybody, well, I want to tell y'all, today is one of my favorite stories in all the Bible. It's a story from the Old Testament, and it's about a guy by the name of Naaman. Okay, so one time there was this Syrian general. He was a war hero. He had medals upon medals, and when he walked around, it went clink, 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 because he had so many medals. Oh, he was an important guy. He had done so much. He was a hero. But there was something wrong with him. He had leprosy. Yeah. It was contagious. But the leprosy, it made his face kind of nasty. So like his nose kind of got nasty. And it can, sometimes nose would fall off. Your ears would fall off. Your skin got all kind of weird. It was a bad disease and eventually it would kill you. And he tried everything to get better, but he just couldn't get better. And then one of his helpers said, I know in Israel there is this prophet by the name of Elijah, and he has worked miracles before. I have seen him do things amazing. Maybe he can help you. And they said, well, we'll give it a try. And so they got their horses, they got all their gold, they got all their treasures, and they started getting their horses, and they went all the way, they went to the king of Israel and said, we hear that you can heal leprosy. And the king, yeah, and the king goes, ah, I can't do that. I don't have that power. He says, but we were told there's a prophet named Elijah. He's like, oh, Elijah, he lives over yonder. Yeah. But so they all went and they had all their horses, all the important men and all their fancy uniforms. And so they go up and they knock on the door. And then here comes this person, this helper for Elijah, and says, can I help you? And they said, this is Naaman. He has leprosy. We want him to be healed. I'll be with you in a minute. Close the door, go back and says, Elijah, there's this guy outside and he has leprosy and he wants to be healed. What should I tell him? And Elijah's, I kind of picture him just sitting inside a rocking chair, just whittling on some wood, you know. Tell him to go dip himself in the Jordan River 7 times. 7 times, yeah. And so they go back and say, I just spoke with Elijah, and he said, for you to be healed of leprosy, I want you to go and to dip in the Jordan River 7 times. And guess what Naaman said? Naaman goes, what? The Jordan, that's a nasty river. I could go to the Green River. I could go to the Rough River. I could go anywhere and do that. Does he not know who I am? I thought he'd come outside and wave a wand or maybe sprinkle some dust on me or do a little chant or something, but tell me to go take a bath in the river. And so Naaman got mad and went, ugh, and just ba-doom, 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 ba-doom. And then one of his servants said, Mr. Naaman, if he had asked you to do something really important, if he had asked you to do something very hard, would you have done it?
Yeah.
Yeah, Naaman says, yeah. And so he said, well, if this is simple, why not just do it? And so guess what Naaman did? He went to the Jordan River. And he went inside there and he said, I don't think this is going to work, but we'll give it a try. And he went under one time. Whoosh. Came up, water. I'm still a leper. Went whoosh. Ah, 3 times. It's not working. 4 times. 5 times. 6 times. And then he went underwater the 7th time.
I know.
Yeah, yeah. And he went underwater. He goes, and when he came up, all of a sudden, his hands, his fingers were back. His nose was there again. His ears was back. And he said, I'm better. I'm healed. And he was excited. Yeah. And so the lesson of the story is sometimes God asks us to do something and we're like, that doesn't make any sense. That is silly. Yeah. But you know what? It's better if we listen to God, isn't it? Yeah. All right? So no matter how silly it is, we need to listen to God and do what God says, okay? Okay, let's go ahead and pray. Yeah, let's go ahead and pray. Ready? Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, thank you so much for all you do for us. And Lord, I pray for these wonderful kids. I pray that they'll always listen to you and do their best to serve you. And Father, just thank you so much for your love and kindness. Bless these kids, and may they have a good week at school. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. All right, y'all, come get your piece of candy.
We are blessed to have Carrie to sing for us this morning. Carrie, thank you.
Notice something that happens when Chris and Peggy play. When they get done, everybody claps. When my girls get done singing, everybody claps. When I get done preaching, everybody leaves. So something's going on. Thank you. But I haven't preached yet. If you have your Bibles, please start going to turn to 1 John chapter 3, and this is probably one of the best chapters in all of Scripture. And I'm going to be reading from the Passion Translation. Now, this is a paraphrase, so it's not an actual translation, but it's such a beautiful way of putting it. It says, "Look with wonder at the depth of the Father's marvelous love that he has lavished on us. He has called us and made us his very own beloved children. The reason the world doesn't recognize who we are is that they didn't recognize him. Beloved, we are God's children right now. However, it is not yet apparent what we will become. But we do know that when it is finally made visible, we will be just like him, for we will see him as he truly is. And all who focus their hope on him will always be. Anyone who indulges in sin lives in moral anarchy. For the definition of sin is breaking God's law. And you know without a doubt that Jesus was revealed to eradicate sins. and there is no sin in him. Anyone who continues to live in union with him will not sin, but the one who continues sinning hasn't seen him with discernment or known him by intimate experience. Delightfully loved children, don't let anyone divert you from this truth. The person who keeps doing what is right proves that he is righteous before God, even as the Messiah is righteous. But the one who indulges in a sinful life is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God was revealed was to undo and destroy the works of the devil. Everyone who is truly God's child will refuse to keep sinning because God's seed remains within him, and he is unable to continue sinning because he has been fathered by God himself. Here is how God's children can clearly be distinguished from the children of the evil one. Anyone who does not demonstrate righteousness and show love to fellow believers is not living with God as his source. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let me ask a simple question. Who are you? And I mean that seriously. Who are you? I have a thing I want you to do when you get home. Don't do it right now, but when you get home, I want you to go look in the mirror. And I want you to look at yourself, and I want you to ask that question, who am I? Who am I really? And then I want you to ask that question, and I want you to say, how did I come to that conclusion? How did I figure that out? Because sometimes we look at ourselves and we say, who I am, and we use like our past experiences, our past mistakes. You know, oftentimes we are so critical of ourselves, we are the hardest people in the world on ourselves because we judge ourselves by our mistakes. And so we look at ourselves and say, what a loser. What a failure. Perhaps it's by your parents. You look in the mirror and say, who are you? And you like, ugh. I know, like, when I look in the mirror, and ever since I was a little kid, I have a lopsided face. Some of y'all look at me like, they're like, what? You know? But one side of my face is lower than the other side. It's been like that since I was a kid. And every time I look at my face, I'm like, you know, trying to fix it. And scotch tape won't do it either. But I look at myself and say, why? God, why did he make me ugly like that? Maybe it's from other folks. Perhaps when you look in the mirror and you look at yourself and you say, who are you? You hear the voice of another person. Maybe it's your mom or your dad. Perhaps it's positive. Maybe your mom says, oh, you are such a good boy. And so you look at your mirror and you say, you're such a good boy. Or perhaps you look in the mirror and say, I can hear my mom's words. What a disappointment. What a loser. What a failure. I've always been amazed at the power we give to other people to define us and how outstanding that is. We allow other people to define who we are and what our worth is. If you've ever taken a Psychology 101 or Sociology 101 class, and you know the concept by Charles Cooley called the looking glass self. And basically, what that principle says is that your self-worth is determined by what you think the most important person in your life thinks of you. So if the most important person in your life is your mother, and your mother says you're a loser, then you're going to see yourself as a loser. If the most important person in your life is your spouse, and your spouse says you are the bomb, you're going to think, I'm the bomb. So I want you to look in the mirror and ask that question, who am I? And that's important because how you see yourself, how you define yourself will determine how you behave, how you treat others, and how you allow others to treat you. So who are you? Who are you? Now let's take that concept of looking glass self. As Christians, Jesus Christ is Lord, right? Jesus is our Lord, he's our Savior. God is supposed to be number one in our lives, right? God is supposed to be the most important person in our lives. So if God is the most important person in our life, then the question we should ask is, what does God think of me? And we take that looking glass self-concept, if God is the most important person in our life, and God says something about us, that's how we should define ourselves. So the question we shouldn't ask is, who am I? But the question should be, who does God say I am? I don't know if y'all have heard that song by Laura Nagel, but it's called You Say. I love the song. The song goes, and don't worry, I won't sing it, even though if I did sing it, you might clap, you know. But it says, you say that I'm loved when I cannot feel a thing. You say I am strong when I am weak. You say I am held when I'm falling short. When I don't belong, you say I'm yours. I love that. That's how God sees it. That's no matter what anybody else says, what God says trumps everything else. You know, I think about that, and I'm sure y'all do too. Anytime someone you love says something derogatory about themselves, if one of my girls says something about themselves, how it's negative, or if my spouse or someone I love says something negative, I think, man, I wish you could just see yourself the way I see you. I wish you could see through my eyes and define yourself by how I am looking at you right now. Because what you think of yourself is not what I see. But could you imagine God saying the same thing? God looking at you saying, stop beating yourself up. Stop putting yourself down. You are mine. You are beloved. And that's why I love what John says here. John in chapter 3 is going to define who we are through something beautiful by reminding us who we are, what we will be, and what we're becoming. So look at verse 1 again. I love this. He says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. And the reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. So the first thing I want you to see, who are you? You are loved by God. Now, we say that all the time. You know, that's just like a little church thing we say, but y'all, don't skip over that. Don't just pass over that like it's nothing. You are loved by God. God. God of the cosmos. The creator of creation. The one who is omnipotent, the one who is omniscient, the one who is all-powerful, the one who can do all things, that God loves you. Think about that. Just when's the last time you stopped and just focused on that? Where you looked in the mirror and said, God loves you. God loves me. And let that sink in to the very depths of your soul. And I love how it says this in verse 1. Now, in the NIV, it doesn't say it, but in the other translations, the word that is used there is called behold. And it just says, behold. And basically it says, stop what you're doing right now. Drop everything. And look at the love of God. Focus. Focus on this love that God has for you. Try to grasp it. Because when you try to grasp it, you will not be able to grasp it. That's how wonderful his love is. In fact, when Paul talked to the Ephesian church, and of all the things he wanted them to try to understand, God's greatness, God's holiness, the one thing he prayed that they would grasp and understand more than anything else was God's love. Ephesians 3, verse 16, I love this. He says, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. He's saying, I want you to look and try to grasp how great God's love is. I want you to gather together with other Christians, and I want you to come together and talk about the love of God and try to figure out how big it is. Because everything we do centers on God's love for us. Behold the love of God. And I love when it says, how great the love of God. Now, that word great there, it is the Greek word potapos, which just sounds wonderful, potapos, you know. But the word, it's one of those weird words because there is no literal translation in the English because it's an idiom. It's a saying. It's kind of like if you went and tried to describe, if you went outside and said, it's raining today, how is it raining? You said, well, it's raining cats and dogs. And then you try to translate that into Japanese or something, and they look, cats and dogs, what? That word, great, what it literally means is, what world is this from? It means, this is unlike anything this world offers. This is so great that nothing in this world can begin to come close to describe what this love is like. This love is so big and so powerful and so foreign to us, it is otherworldly. We cannot begin to grasp how powerful and how mighty God's love is. And that's why I'll tell you, of all the books that I've read, of all the people I've read, the deepest and most profound theologians that I have ever read are those who cannot begin to grasp how ungraspable the love of God is. It's those who stand in awe of God's love and says, I can't put words to this. I can't explain how much God loves me except just to say Jesus. Karl Barth, one of the greatest theologians of all time, wrote a book called How Then Shall We Live? Talks about Christ and culture. Just one of these great theologians, wrote scholarly articles one after the other. One time he was asked, Dr. Barth, what is the most profound Christian thought you have ever had? And he thought for a second. He said, the most profound thing that's ever come across my mind is this. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And I want you to imagine if you could grasp that. If right now you looked in the mirror and you just focused on God's love, what that would mean. And to look at that person in the mirror and say, God loves you. We often sing that song, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be, oh, how wonderful, oh, how marvelous, is my Savior's love for me. And it says, how great the Father's love that he bestows upon us. And I love this. In the NIV it says lavished, but it says bestow. And that's just kind of an odd way of saying things. Because like when I talk to my wife, I say, honey, I love you. I don't say, honey, I bestoweth my love upon thee. Unless I'm breaking out the King James, you know. It's romantic night at the Robinson household and we're going King James, you know. But behold, it's something you place upon someone. Like, you know, when you knight someone, you bestow upon them this title. You give it to them. And when it says he lavishes his on, what it means is that he bestows. It's where God places his love on us to such a degree that it permanently changes who we are. It changes who we are. It's kind of like this. I love my wife. I loved her before we got married, but when we got married, something happened. I bestowed my love upon her. I, in a special, unique way, gave my love to her, placed it upon her, and at that point, she was changed. Because at that point, she was no longer Denise Diane Dean, but she became Denise Diane Robinson. My love was placed on her and literally changed her name. Well, when God bestows his love on us, it changes us. And we are transformed. We go from simply being a creation of God, made in his image, to being get this, a child of God. When we respond by saying yes to God, it literally changes us. We are adopted into the family of God. We receive his spirit. We cry out, Abba. We become his child. In John chapter 1 of the gospel, John writes this. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. But listen to this. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. Now think about the love that God, I mean, it would have been powerful if God's love simply says, I will save you from your sins. You don't get to go to hell. That's love. It would have been God's love if he just would have stopped and said, I will cleanse you, I will make you new. That would have been great. But the love to take you and make you part of the family. I told a story one time during one of our Wednesday night Bible studies. But one day, we used to have this dog named Little Bear. And y'all, you've heard me talk about Little Bear. Little Bear was a demon dog. And we had to give him up. But wherever that dog is now, my guess is there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, okay? But so we got rid of the dog. And I was at a point where I said, we will never have another dog ever again. Well, my three little girls were out on the trampoline, and they're pastor's kids, and so when you're on trampoline, what do? You pray. And so they're on the trampoline, and they're like, it's a summer day. It's perfect. The only thing that's missing is a dog. And so they started praying for a dog. Now, y'all understand where we lived at that time, we lived on an end of the road that included the Humane Society. So when people did not want to pay to drop their dog off of the Humane Society, they went to the end of our road and dropped their dogs off at the end of our road. And so the girls are praying for this dog, that God would send a dog, and lo and behold, what comes out of the woods? This flea-bitten, nasty-looking dog just comes up, looking like a zombie dog. And it was funny is that the dog they thought was a beagle dog. It had a beagle mix. And so they wanted to call it beagle, but they mispronounced it, so they called him bagel. And so they said, God answered our prayer. Oh, bagel. And they all love him. And of course, they come, Dad, Mom. Well, I'll tell you how it started. They said, can we keep him? No. Well, then we understood, we got coyotes all over the place. This dog's going to die if we let it just be loose. So we'll just keep him close to the house. Well, he's hungry. Well, we got to feed him. We give him a piece of bologna. He's thirsty. Give him a little, get one of Mom's Tupperware bowls, put a little water in it, put it outside. Well, then that transformed to, well, this dog is dirty. Well, let's just give him a little bath. And then all of a sudden, he's like, well, where's he going to sleep? Well, let's just open the garage door a little bit. And y'all, that dog went from being a stray dog that nobody loved to being saved, to being cleansed, to where then he became a part of our family. And that dog's life was forever changed when he became not just a dog, but when he became my dog. You are a child of God. You belong to him. So, who are you? Look at the mirror. You're God's child. You look in the mirror and you say who, and I don't care who else says, because right now that is who you are, and don't forget it. Now, real quick, let me just go through this because it gets even better. Because right now that is who you are. But look who you are becoming. Look at verse 2. Dear friends, now, no matter how it looks, but right now, we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Right now, you are a child of God. You say, I don't feel like, doesn't matter. God says you are. I don't look it, God says you are. Have y'all ever saw the movie Princess Diaries? Okay, let me show this picture. Before and after. Okay? But let me tell you, she was declared to be a princess in the before picture. That's when she was a princess. She just grew into the role of being a princess. You are declared to be a child of God. You grow into that. But right now, God declares this is who you are. And one day you will realize that. We can't begin to comprehend what we're going to look like when Christ comes back. We're going to be changed. We'll be like him. It's kind of like this. Could you imagine trying to explain to a caterpillar what a butterfly is? Go to the caterpillar and says, hey, you see that butterfly? That's you. No. Yes, that's you. That's what you're going to look like. Not me. Yes, you. Y'all, how glorious is going to be when Christ returns and we get to see each other as we truly are. And so because of that, who should we be now? Verse 3. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. In other words, this is who you are. This is who you're going to be. So now start living your life in that way of who you are. I've always loved this about the scriptures, that the Bible, the call for holiness, always starts with a place of position. You don't behave in order to earn God's love. You behave because you are loved by God. You do not pursue holiness to become a child of God. You pursue holiness because God has already declared you to be a child of God. Purify yourselves. So what does this mean? Real quick, our time's up. But first is this, remember who you are. Verse 7. Dear children, do not anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does not what is righteous is sinful, is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. No one who is born of God will continue to sin because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. This is how we know who the children of God, children of the devil are. Anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother or sister. Remember who you are. You are a child of God. You're not a child of the devil. When you go start to do something silly and you know it's bad, remember who your daddy is. You belong to God. Act like it. Second thing, remind yourself of his grace. Look at verse 5, I love this. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. When you mess up, when you fail, when you sin, you remind yourself that Christ died for your sins. In him there is no condemnation whatsoever. So stop trying to earn his favor. Understand, he has already forgiven you. And third, remain in him. Look at verse 6. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him nor known him. In other words, abide. The word in him, it's abideth in him. It means stay close. And it's amazing when you stay close to God how that changes you, how that impacts you. So let me ask you this. Who are you? Who are you? I'll close with this story. Fred Craddock one time told a story about a time when he was in Cosby, Tennessee, is right outside of Gatlinburg, and he was there having a meal at a diner, and there was this old man walking around, going to table, shaking hands and loving on folks and all this. And so he came up to their table and says, so hey, where are y'all from? And Fred Craddock said, well, we're from Oklahoma. He says, well, what do you do? He says, well, I'm a seminary professor. He goes, well, guess what? I got you a good preaching story. And y'all know that every time you hear a preacher, a preacher's got to tell it. I got a good story for you. Or you're with me, they say, hey, I got a good joke for you. But he said, there was this little boy who his mom gave birth to him out of wedlock. His dad wouldn't have anything to do with him. And everybody around town knew that he didn't know his daddy. And so it became a running joke, you know, in those days, he said that folks didn't take too kindly to that kind of thing. And he said when he got around town that folks would laugh and mock him. At school, the kids made fun of him. And he said that it made him feel low down and dirty. It made him feel like he wasn't worthy, and he'd fight folks all the time. But he said he wanted to go to church, and he'd go to church across the railroad tracks just because he didn't want people to realize he got tired of people saying, "Who's your daddy?" Well, he went to church for a while and always came in early, always left early so that folks couldn't see him. But one day there was a crowd, and he couldn't get out fast enough, and there was a guest preacher in town. And as a boy started to run, this guest preacher just saw this young 12-year-old boy off by himself without his parents, so he grabbed him and said, "Son, come here. Who's your daddy?" And the little boy just stopped, and everybody kind of froze because they knew the story. And the preacher knew that something had been done, so he looked at this boy and said, "Let me get a good look at you. Yep, I can see the resemblance right now. You look just like your daddy." And he said, "You are a child of God." And he turned around, slapped him on the bottom, and said, "Now go out there and claim your inheritance, boy." And he said he took off, and he just was felt like a new young man. He later would give his life to Christ, be baptized, join the church and all that. But when he left, Fred Craddock and his wife just like, well, said, "Wow, that was a good story." And someone came up to him and said, "Do you know who that guy was?" He said, "No." He said, "His name was Ben Hopper," Ben Hooper, excuse me. He was a governor of Tennessee in the early 1900s. But he said that incident changed his life. I want this to change your life. Who are you? You are a child of God. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, we are so grateful for the love of Christ that has been poured upon us, that has been lavished on us, bestowed upon us, that changes who we are. We belong to you. You are ours. We belong to you. And Father, no matter what the world says about us, how it beats us down, no matter what we go through, may we never forget we are your child. Thank you, Lord, for the cross that made it possible, for the sacrifice that was made, for the love that was given, for the life we now have because of Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Yeah. Blood stained brown. This
powerful is the love of God. Let's bow our heads and be dismissed. Dear Heavenly Father, as we now leave this place, may we go forth knowing we are your beloved children, and may we go show the world what the family of God looks like. Father, may we go forth and share his love with others. May you be with us and guide us now and forevermore. In Christ we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thanks again for your help yesterday.